Series. You're joining me at the very end of the session. It's been an interesting one. Basically, I arrived on a Friday afternoon and I'll fish through till Monday morning. I'm on Meadow Lodge Fisheries. This is the specimen carp lake I'm on, and it's about a 4 acre water, maybe 4.5, and there's a lot of big fish in here. There's fish up to touching 40 pound, there's at least 5 different fish over 30 pound, and there's a fair few back up 20s. It's an ultra hard water from the point of view of it sees pressure pretty much every day, 360 odd days of the year. And that makes it for some of the most pressured fish in the country. They've seen it all, they've eaten it all, and they've had it all. So, finding the key to unlock the door is sometimes quite hard. That said, if you're in the swim and they're in front of you and they're hungry, you can get some very nice hits. So, as I said, I arrived here Friday afternoon. The lake was fairly packed already. So I dropped into number 6 when I arrived, which is the pad swim. You're fishing no more than about a rod to 2 rod lengths out. So it's real short range fishing. And basically on Saturday evening I managed to nick one, 22 pound 4 ounce, first off the blocks for me for this year. So that's quite a nice start, actually, having a 20 under the belt first draws. So come the afternoon on Sunday, one of the lads was moving out of the swim up for me, and that was proving to be the hot swim of the session. A lot of fish were showing out in front of number 7, which is the next swim up for me, and that's called the snags. So what I did, I decided to pack away all the gear, move up on Sunday afternoon and do a quick overnighter in the snag swim. But the problem is it didn't really pay off. The weather went very cold last night, and we actually had a big dense fog settling over us for the whole night, and it was Baltic cold. Frost, dew, mist, fog, the lot. It kind of killed the fishing. So it's now about 11 o'clock on Monday morning. I'm packing up the gear, I'm going home. But I've enjoyed the session, it's been interesting. I've learned a little bit, and I've had a fish, so I'm not grumbling. I like to have everything prepared before I go fishing, so that when I arrive I can just cast out. So a couple of days prior to fishing, I started my bait preparation by boiling up some groats and some hemp. When that was done, I got to preparing both my pop-up hook baits and my stick mix, or my bag mix. We'll be right back. When I arrived, there'd been a few quality fish out, so I spent some time searching to see if I could find some for myself. Tip that I've been using for years, one I think is a real edge. Basically, I've got some freezer baits here and they're beginning to defrost. So if you add a liquid food while it's defrosting, it can give you a real boost to your bait. So what I like to add are liquid foods. I don't really like to put too much in the way of flavors in, but I do like sort of, you know, the Multimino, Nutrimino, that kind of thing. So what I've been using in this session is this. This is the Trigger liquid booster. Now, all the liquid boosters in the range come with their different signature flavors in them. This is obviously Trigger, and this contains all the range of the liquid boosters. I'm going to run through the list of ingredients because it's quite extensive, and I have to say Nutribase done a top bang up job of making these boosters, because it's exactly what I would add in numerous forms. So basically they've got the nutritional liquid food, which is the stuff that you would actually roll a bait with. So it's got that in it. It also has nature identical flavour. Well, obviously there's no flavour in this one apart from the Trigger flavour. It contains dissolved betaine HC1. Betaine, I believe, is to be one of the finest ingredients for attracting fish. Organic acids, kajalsas, natural sugars and emulsifiers. So it has the whole gambit in there. And what I do is, as they start to defrost, I like to pour in about 10 mil or so onto the actual baits themselves. of the liquid booster. I also have the actual liquid food, and I go a little bit less with this. So that's about 5 mils. And what I do then is I close up the packet nice and tight. I'm gonna make sure this is closed for this bit. So once it's closed, I give it a good shake round. So all those liquids coat the boilies, and as they're defrosting, they then suck them in. I find it is a real added attraction for the fish. It really gets their heads down. So on top of that, I like to go one step further. Once they're coated, I like to take some of the green lipid mussel extract, which is one of the finest carp attractors, along with betaine in my opinion. And I only put a small half teaspoon in, coating the baits, and I give them another good shake around. And when they're done, they absorb all the liquid, and they then have a nice sticky feel to them, which I find is a real bonus for the fish. They really get switched on to the bait a lot quicker. So we just let them defrost now. And here's the other little thing. When you're using something like the trigger, most people would let them air dry. They'd take them out. If I'm only fishing for 2 or 3 days, I'd actually tend to leave them in their bags defrosted. The reason being, I think the sweating process in the bag, because it's an enzyme-rich product and it's an active bait, I think it activates those enzymes and they become very attractive again to the carp. It stimulates them a lot quicker. So I tend not to air dry them. If I was more than 2 or 3 days on a session, then I would most certainly be looking to air dry them. But to be honest with you, I find for a couple of days, once you've got them coated in that liquid, they'll last really, really well in the plastic bags. You can either pop them open and let them breathe, or you can keep them closed. Keeping them closed, I find, especially if it's a warmish day in the daytime, will make them sweat a little bit more. And I think that gets the sugars and the components breaking down a lot quicker. So that's a little tip. I've been using it for years. It has worked for me. I do think it's a great little edge. Using, as I said, really good ingredients, such as the boosters and the liquid foods. You can't overkill the baits with these because they're fully natural and they are not artificial. They're not full of bits and bobs that are going to repel the fish. You can't repel the fish with these things. You could put the whole bottle in and it wouldn't really make that much difference apart from your pocket. Anybody who knows me knows my complete and utter love for multi-rigs. I've used them for a while now, and I've played around with the rigs. I use them, the multi-rig, for both pop-ups, whether I fish them on the deck, you know, sort of with the putty right close to the eye, or whether I fish them, you know, an inch, 2 inches high. Also, I use them for my bottom bait rig. Now, this would be a bottom bait rig that I would use in a PVA bag, or with just a bit of nugget of foam put on it. And You know, hookling material is really a personal choice. If I'm in a PVA bag, then it's obviously going to be braid, which I'm using here. If it's just going to be cast out with a piece of foam on it, then I probably would go with one of the coated braids. But this is the rig I'm using on this trip. Now, it's very, very simple. This is the bottom rig, and its mechanics are slightly different from the normal multi-rig that I would tie, which would be for the pop-up. So basically it's about probably about 8-9 inches of braid, and the loop that I make is very long. It's usually about 2.5 inches, give or take, and there's a reason for that, because I want this part to be as kind of stiff and confusing for the carp as it goes in. I want this to be stiffer than the main supple braid. What I do is I put a little bit of shrink tube on it, and I also then have the actual looped part coming down, so it's kind of in line with the actual barb. You can adjust it through the actual the shrink tube, which is great anyway. And I don't really put too much of a kick on the tubing. It's just purely to give it a little bit of an extension. On that, I have then a very, very small ringed swivel, and it gives the bait plenty of motion and movement. On this type of rig, I would either fish wafters or I would fish sort of a snowman rig. And as I say, this is my bottom bait rig. I don't need any putty just down below, but at the end of the 2 inches, I have one of the Tasker tungsten baseline beads, and I use the oval one, which is one of the biggest ones, and I think that gives it a nice little bit of weight, so that when the fish does pick up and suck in the bait, it gives that little bit of weight to pull, help pull the hook in the right direction. Now, because I have used braid in this is very similar to my rig that I used in France, except for I was using the iCore Zero as a hook length material, which is really, really heavy, and I was using a size 4 hook. But the actual movement part of the swivel on the ring allows for that blowback effect, which, you know, helps the hook pull in with the weight of the bait. I'm using a size 6 ace hook. I have seen the prototypes to the new Tasker hooks, and I have to say I'm dying for them to get going on them, because believe it or not, the ace hooks were created by Steve Tasker, and then the company was taken over, sold off, and Ace was created. But the actual Ace hooks were designed by Steve Tasker, and Steve Tasker's had a massive hand in the new development of the hooks that are going to be out in the Tasker range shortly. And I'm dying to get on them, because Ace hooks, in my opinion, are, as it stands, are the best hook on the market, and unfortunately you can't get them anymore, so that's a real pain in the you know what. So the components are really easy to build. You know, it's a very quick and easy rig to tie up with minimal of fuss, but it's a very, very effective catcher of carp. It's basic, but it does the job. So as I say, if I'm using wafters or snowmen, this is my preferred bottom bait rig. And as I said, if I was going for more of a casting rig, then I would obviously use one of the many coated braids out on the market, and I would just maybe shorten that slightly and put the bead a bit closer, maybe. Depends on you know, a number of other factors though. But yeah, it's a great rig. So I'm going to take a bait, one of my freezer triggers here that I've been soaking in the special concoction. Go straight through the actual bait itself. Thread that on, and I pull that down over the actual barrel of the swivel. Now I'm using also the pink pepper pop-ups in 12mm, which just gives it enough lift without lifting the bait off the bottom. I have these soaking in the trigger booster and GLM. And again, it's just, a lot of people try these on. I find for a snowman, you're quite okay just to thread it through the bait and needle. It doesn't really have any effect on the overall buoyancy of the bait. So once that's through, it's going to sit like so. And what I do is I prefer these hair stops. These are the Tasker. They've got a slight banner on them. What I tend to do, when I get in close on this, I'll push this down in the middle of the actual floss, push it down into it so it's sitting like so. And then it's a case of just tying a couple of overhand loops. Well, once that's tied off like so, it's a simple case of just nipping it off. And then I get a lighter and I just glob the old ends. You'll have to forgive me, it's a bit breezy here today. And I just gently pull doily back up into that stop so it's actually got a little bit of separation from the hook. So when the fish picks it up, there is, you can see the actual pivot on the blowback, and job is oxo. It's a great little rig, one that I've been tinkering around with for a while. Got the components right, it sits really well in the water. Bottom, the bait will just sit above the hook itself, and it seems to be a real nice hooker of the fish. A lot of people use very short hook lengths. I'm not a big fan. I prefer a little bit of movement, especially because the type of lakes I fish tend to be a lot more choddy, a lot more weed. And as I say, if I was casting out this, I'd put on two bits of foam. And actually, while I'm here, I'm going to talk to you about the foam, because the foam is really important. I've done a lot of underwater testing with foam, and then most of it doesn't come off the way you think it's going to come off. Most people just take a piece of foam, they stick the hook in it, and then what they do is they do this, and so that the hook's in the middle of it, and then they take the bait, throw it over, they wrap it around like so, give it a quick lick, and that's how they would cast out. I've found that to be the worst way of doing it. Reason being, I've found the PVA nuggets don't melt. Even in the height of summer, I've been out in a boat and I've gone over a PVA nuggeted rig, and I've 3 hours later it's still on it and it's still off the deck. So the way I do it is real simple. Take my nugget, I lay it onto it, just nicking, if you can see this, just slightly nicking the actual foam with the hook. It's a very small nick. And then I take my other one, I lick it, and I put it over it. And then I pinch the two sides. So now it looks like that. So it's every piece goes out with two. And that actually has water, so it can flow right up the center column, and it will pop off within less than 30 seconds or more. I've never seen this stay on longer than a minute. But it's really, really important to have this set up like this, because the other way just doesn't work, and I've proven that to myself so many times. I just won't use PVA foam in any other manner now. So, you know, these are the things you should be testing in the edge. You know, try them out, see for yourself, because it really does make such a difference. If you don't have if you're just guessing at stuff, you can be doing it all wrong, and it can be really, really detrimental to your catch rates. last knockings for me. It's been a bit of a grueler of a session. I've had one already, and it's been 2 days of nothingness. And I'm just sort of doing a slow pack up, and this has gone off. This is a fish known as the pug, and it's 24 pound 4 ounces. It's called a pug for a reason, because it has a bit of a deformed snout, a real character of a fish. But I'm very, very happy with this now. Came on the Nutribaits trigger, topped with a snowman with the pink pepper pop-up. Fished over a bed of trigger pellets and mush, which I made up earlier on in the week. But it seems to have worked a trick there. This is the first time trigger's been used on this venue, and it's an instant bait, so it's not a worry about whether you'll catch on it or not. It's just whether the fish are in front of you or not. Fish have been shown in front of me for most of the morning, actually, and very slow take this one, but as I said, very, very happy. I'm going to get her back now. So I'm using PVA bags. Even though I'm using a bait boat, I'm using the PVA bags for a very specific reason. A lot of people think that, you know, once you've got a bait boat, you don't ever go back to PVA, and that's not quite true. You can use PVA if you use it wisely. Now, the reason why I'm using it is I'm not setting up the PVA bag as a standard PVA bag. I'm doing it with a bit of a twist. I'm going to show you it now. So I'm using quite a large bag. These are the Tasker PVA breakdown bags. The size of these are 90 by 160. So I want them fairly big, and the reason being is because what I'm doing is I'm flattening them down to make a pancake. So that's the PVA bag ready to go out. Now, the reason why I want it to be flat, so when I fill the hopper, I backfill it towards the back of the boat with more of the feed, and place this down on top of it so it stays above the waterline so it doesn't get splashed. The reason why I want this flat is there's a lot of carpet weed out there, and there's some very dense weed. Now, if you can find spots where the carpet weed is, when you empty the bait boat, this flutters down, and because of the flat pancake, will actually lay down and compress any of the weed in the area, so that this will then sit on top of it. Inside the presentation is a simple trigger and a pink pepper snowman. The trigger is a freezer bait, and I've been glugging it in my secret special cocktail, which I've already shown you. And it's an instant bait. Fish have never seen the trigger here before. This is the first time it ever going in, and they certainly, I've had as many fish as anybody else. So, the bait is not the issue, it's the location at the moment, and the fact that conditions haven't been that brilliant to bring the fish on. Last week was like Siberia up here. I mean, it was Baltic cold. Temperatures in the day were only 3 to 5 degrees. Now this week it's meant to be 13 to 14. At the back end of this week, it's to go up to about 15 or 16, maybe even up to 17 or 18 over the weekend. Now the weekend there is a little bit of rain due in. Meadow Lodge again. The plan was that I was going to fish Monday to Friday, Friday morning, pack up, head down to the lock and fish for the weekend down on the lock in Cork. I'm not really a big fan of fishing in Cork on my own. The lock is an urban situation and look, you know, you can be very safe down there and then you can be very unlucky down there. It has happened in the past. And I always think, you know, safety in numbers is always the best option. So I decided that what I was going to do was, because my buddy pulled out at the very last minute on Friday, I decided I'd go off to the movies, have a bit of time with the family. And now Sunday afternoon, I came back to Meadow Lodge to do a quick overnighter. Don't know whether you can hear it in the background, but that's thunder. Conditions look so good for it. There have been a couple of fish out since I left on Friday. There have been a few fish out, and you know, the lake has switched on a little bit. Most of the fish are up in the shallow end, a lot of the smaller fish. I still think the bigger ones are down here though. That's why I've come into number 8, which is at the bottom end of the lake. It's deeper water. Hopefully we'll get something tonight, but listen, it's a quick overnighter to finish off my week's fishing. Conditions, as I say, have been really, really good for the day. We've had temperatures up to 20 degrees. A lot of the fish then immediately zoomed up to the shallows there and basked in the sunshine. I do feel though that a lot of the smaller fish went running up there. I'm not so sure the bigger fish plodded up there, but we'll see. It's been beautiful all afternoon. As I say, it's 20 degrees. It's now sort of coming to dusk now, you know, it's coming to the evening time now. And the weather has changed again a little bit. It's still very mild. It's to not drop below 11 degrees tonight, which is superb. And there are thunder systems running through for the next couple of hours at least. And I always found thunder to be, and you know, that sort of, especially in hot weather, to be a real sort of stimulation for the carp to get their heads down. Look, all you can do is your best, all you can do is try, and that's what I'm gonna try and do. See if I can winkle out a carp. There's the lightning now. We should get another clap of thunder in about 2 seconds. On cue. It just feels so good for a bite. Just has that airiness of you know, you get that vibe when you're fishing. Sometimes conditions feel just spot on, and they are spot on at the moment. I'm not saying I'm going to get anything. It's going to start raining again now. I'm not going to say I'm going to get anything, but there's a guy down below me and there's two at the top here and there's one on the other side, which is fairly busy for a Sunday evening. But as I say, it's starting to rain again. You get these sort of short cloud bursts, and then a bit of a clap of thunder and maybe a flash. But as I said, I fancy the conditions. I really do think they're spot on now for a fish. Confidence is quite high. I'm just worried that maybe all the fish did go up the top end in the shallows in the sunshine, but not seen any show since I've been here. Nothing, not one. There's another flash of lightning now. I haven't seen anything. Storm's getting a bit closer because you know, the lightning and the thunder are kind of closer together now. As I said, early May, we've had really cold conditions for the first part of this week just gone by, and it's now perfect, real carpy. So look, I'll talk to you in the morning. Hopefully I'll have something in the net during the night or early mornings, but we'll see what happens. there you go, 13 pound 2 ounces. Not the biggest fish in the lake, but certainly a nice one to catch. It's a very pretty looking fish. The rig is obviously working well, using the pancaked PVA bags out the back of the bait boat with a load of trigger carpet feed and pellet. Seems to be doing the job. Because the onion grass is about 6 to 8 inches off the deck out there, using the pancaked PVA bag, it sinks down and lays flat on top of the grass and pushes it down, giving a spot for a fish to come in and hover over. It seems to be working, so I'm not going to knock the method. Yes, it's not a huge fish, but you know what? I was staring down the barrel of a blank here for the night, and it's 7 a.m. and it rattled off. So yeah, I'm well chuffed. Now I'm going to give it to about midday today, and then I'll be on my toes again. But yeah, I'm well chuffed with this one. Norman in the background there is doing a little bit of work on the lake. He's actually come in to do a bit of weed removal and bring the reeds back. We've got 15 years of this lake developing, and this machine, this contraption on his boat will absolutely take out all the reeds and some of the weeds as well, which is really, really what we want. But it's going to be interesting for the guys fishing over the next 24 hours. Me, I think it's time to pack up.